All right. We're talking big budget box office
big
bombs.
Big budget bombs.
Starting with the action reimagining of space opera, whatever.
You almost made my coffee shoot out of my nose.
The Channing Tatum attached action reimagining of the Wizard of Oz. Actually.
The Wizard of Oz. Yeah.
He actually was attached to this movie.
He was.
Yeah. So anyway, Jude, why don't you tell us about this movie? Why don't you tell us how much this movie bombed by and what were the consequences of that?
Okay. So Jupiter Ascending, 2015. I'll give you the synopsis first. A young woman discovers her destiny as an heiress of intergalactic nobility and must fight to protect the inhabitants of Earth from an ancient and destructive industry. So I'll tell you what the budget was, and then I want you to guess how much they made. Okay, so the budget was $176 million plus marketing costs. And I think they had to do a bunch of reshoots, didn't they?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep.
Do you want to round that number up?
So roughly $200 million.
Okay. $200 million budget. Mm-hmm. And how much did it make? I'm going to guess under $100 million.
No.
No, you are incorrect.
It's more than $100 million?
Mila Kunis, Channing Tatum. People went to see this movie.
Okay, well, I guessed wrong, so go next.
Okay.
$107,500.
The price is right.
Yes. And $1, Bob.
I know Kadish already knows what it grossed. Did you have a guess prior to looking it up?
Well, you had told me while we were watching the movie how much it made. So.
Okay. What did? Okay, fine.
So how much did it make?
It grossed $183 million. So it lost $87 million.
Okay. It's not as bad as I thought. But still.
Those are some solid solo numbers.
Yeah.
It was beaten its opening weekend by the movie SpongeBob.
Ow.
Yeah.
Well, come on, it's SpongeBob.
I hate SpongeBob.
Not just the SpongeBob movie, Sponge Out of Water. So it was the sequel to the SpongeBob movie.
Oh, it was
movie.
A sequel.
Is that the live action one with people in it?
Yeah, I believe it had Keanu Reeves.
There's a
in
live
it.
Action SpongeBob movie?
It wasn't live action. It had like live action elements
when they,
to it.
When they got out of the water.
It was an action reimagining with Keanu Reeves attached to it.
Okay, anyway, Jupiter Ascending.
So it was the Wachowskis' third big budget flop in a row, the other two being Speed Racer and Cloud Atlas. It got nominated for 6 Golden Raspberry Awards, including Worst Picture, Worst Actor, Worst Actress, Worst Supporting Actor, Worst Director, Worst Screenplay, and Eddie Redmayne won for Worst Supporting Actor.
He always talks like this.
That's exactly right.
How dare
his
you?
His whispers throughout this entire movie drove me crazy.
My family has run this galaxy from the start.
And then he'll just randomly yell.
Yeah. He's like the best character in the movie.
He was the best character. That's not saying much about the movie, but you're right.
Yeah.
He was the most dedicated to his craft.
He's award-winning actor Eddie Redmayne.
Right.
Who is he in Harry Potter?
He was Newt Salamander.
He's not in Harry Potter.
He's the main character of the
Beast. Of the
Fantastic. That's the same dude?
Yeah. The Fantastic Beasts, yeah.
He was also Newt in the Aeronauts with, what's her name?
He like really is different.
Have you seen him in The Dutch Girl?
It looks like he has cotton balls stuck in his lips.
Yeah,
his
whiskers
constantly like this.
He's got very collagen lips. Collagen.
I almost thought it was a voice actor doing him.
Like overdubbed.
Yeah.
No, it was like him. He was trying to do Brando.
Oh, this movie, though.
Yeah, terrible version of it, though.
Yeah, like a bad Brando.
Yeah.
Like a skinny Brando.
I'm going to make him an offer he cannot refuse.
You're going to be my daughter's wedding.
I don't know. I kind of like this movie. But
Are you serious?
It's parts of it.
Tell me about it. What did you like?
I liked, you know, I'm a very visual guy.
Right.
The special effects in this movie were killer. They were really good. Okay.
Imaginative.
But I think the thing I like most about this movie is just the different aliens and the different species and stuff.
Ugh.
Yeah, I do. I just bad dislike Rossi. But they were like really, they seemed really out of place to me. Like the dragon dudes, they look like something like straight out of like a Dragonlance, what a Dragonlance movie should be. If you guys are familiar with that at all, it's a Dungeons and Dragons world.
Okay.
That's in populated.
There's lizard
by,
people.
There's well, they're dragons.
Dragon people.
And they're called dragonkin.
Okay.
And they're just like that. Like that's right out of the book. They look exactly like that. Guys, those guys. But
I'll give them points for creativity.
Yeah.
There's no lack of that.
It was weird. They had a lot of weird stuff in this movie, but
they kind of based all the aliens on like human animal hybrids, and so like some of the aliens just had a very weird design. Like there was that. That half elephant guy,
that was weird.
Yeah, and like that was just like weird,
and he was like trumpeting when he was flying.
and then there was the huge ears on like that one species.
Yeah,
like,
that one girl.
Yeah, it was just like they look so goofy.
Yeah,
you know, like it was hard to take the show. Like I understood what they were going for, but it was hard to take it seriously because the aliens just didn't look cool to me.
Yeah, it had,
they look goofy.
I got kind of like a Fifth Element vibe from it.
Well, that I think the Fifth Element was definitely an influence on this film.
Yeah it just I don't know, man.
It all looked weird, but the effects were done well. But but they looked weird.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Yeah, even the spaceships, like they designed the spaceships around different animals or insects depending on the spaceship.
Right.
But they had like these weird things where like
they were just kind of floating.
Not everything was attached to the spaceship. Like they had wings, but they were like
held together with like force fields.
Yeah. Like something weird. And they would like shape shift and do like weird stuff.
I liked the whole folding space, the light speed effects and stuff. But you know, CGI, fancy CGI in today's movies isn't that big of a deal.
The time, what year did this come out, Jude?
2015.
It's not that long ago.
Yeah. Wow. Feels like it's been longer.
Well, they started shooting it, I believe, in 2013 or 2012, one of those two. Like, it was a very long production. Like, they spent, I think, 6 to 8 months just doing, like, kind of pre-vis work, like, working out all, like, the skating. They built, like, this huge half-pipe ramp in Germany or something like that. And they were trying.
Skating was so lame.
Well, rollerblading Wolfman.
Yeah.
Well, what was interesting is that they didn't want to use digital stuntmen in the movie because I think the Wachowskis, when they tried that with The Matrix Reloaded,
It looks terrible.
Yeah, it looked really bad. So they wanted to have like the special effects look like have like the actual actors in them. So a lot of this stuff was like, you know, Channing Tatum and Mila Kunis against green screens. In fact, it took them like 7 months to like shoot like all the kind of like background plates and stuff for this.
I bet you they're really good at rollerblading now though.
Well, it was funny because Channing Tatum actually had never rollerbladed before when he was cast. They were like, can you skate on these things? And he's like, I don't know, I'll learn.
And, give me a couple of weeks.
Yeah. And he was like really bad at it.
Yeah, I bet.
And so he was like, at some point he was just like, okay, I'm going to put these on at the start of my day and never take them off. And so like after a week of just like wearing them like 24 hours a day, he eventually learned how to rollerblade. But it was funny because like he never quite mastered like stopping. So like there are lots of bloopers where like he
just
like
goes off the screen.
Yeah. Well, like he misses his mark and like he'll, because I mean he was doing some really complicated stuff, like, you know, skating around having to like, you know, throw a punch and like turn on like,
yeah, use his little shield thing and then shoot
and hang on to her the whole time.
Yeah, so like he was doing like, he was, you know, constantly missing like, you know, his marks and stuff.
Okay, so besides like the awkwardness of a lot of the scenes, I don't know, the acting was very like they didn't know what, I don't know, I felt like Mila Kunis didn't know what this movie was about.
Well, she didn't.
No one did.
Here's what I noticed on the rewatch of this movie.
Rewatch? You've seen it before?
Oh yeah, I watched it a couple times before. It's literally like five different acts of Channing Tatum's Wolf Boy rescuing Mila Kunis.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a total damsel in distress movie times five.
Yeah.
It's really is. It's like she's a dumb idiot and
she keeps getting in situations where he has to go and
rescue her on his fancy gravity rollerblades.
Yeah. Yeah. So can I tell you guys a little bit about the script to this movie?
Oh boy. This sounds.
Can we? Oh, you can.
So the original script that the Wachowskis wrote was over 600 pages long.
And okay, well, how does that compare to us non-Hollywood people to a normal script?
So basically, the way a script works is that one page of script equates to 1 minute of screen time. So your average movie script is 120 pages.
Okay.
At most, 200 pages is pushing it. This was 600 pages.
So they wrote four movies?
basically.
And tried to squeeze it into one.
But it was funny because, like, when the actors were asked, like, what the movie's about. So, like, Channing Tatum did, like, a Q&A with fans on Reddit. And one of them asked them what the movie was about. And he was like, good question. I have the same question myself.
I don't know.
And, I watched, a making of behind the scenes on YouTube about this movie. And whenever they asked, like, the actors to describe the movie, it was so funny because Mila Kunis was on there. And she was like, the script was very dense. And then Sean Bean was, he described the script as complex. And he says, like, you're not going to get it the first time you read it. And it's kind of funny because, like, if you always look at bad movies, the people, when they talk about the script, they always talk about how, like, they couldn't understand it, but they were sure it was brilliant.
Yeah.
Like, if you look at...
They try so hard not to talk shit about it.
Yeah.
That's their job.
Like, if you look at Ben Affleck and what he was talking about with Batman v Superman, he'd always talk about how, like, the concepts in the script were just, like, so complex that it took him a while to wrap his brain around it. And when I heard him say that, I was like, oh, so the script didn't make any sense. And it was...
He's an Oscar-winning writer, right? For Argo and other couple movies?
Well, he got director for Argo, and he got screenplay for Good Will Hunting.
Okay.
This movie was a really poorly written movie. And the Wachowskis, basically, they wanted to do a sci-fi version of The Odyssey, but they also incorporated elements of The Wizard of Oz into it. And so their idea for Jupiter Jones, the main character, was like a Dorothy-like character who's just kind of a regular girl who's thrust into this fantastic situation, and she just kind of goes through it with her protector dog. So so they said that Cain Wise, who's
I get it now. Channing Tatum is Toto.
Channing Tatum is Toto, and he's her loyal dog, who just his job is to protect her throughout the movie.
There's so much wrong with this.
Jesus Christ.
So that infamous scene where he's like, I have more in common with a dog than a human. And she's like, I love dogs. I love dogs. Like, I always thought that was the scene. I've never seen this movie before, but I've heard people talk shit about that scene. And I'm like, yeah, that's a really bad line of dialogue. Yeah. Immediately after that is like, the joke is that she knows it was a terrible thing to say. Like, it was so stupid. And I'm like, well, that changes the context of it then.
She because totally they're like, to bang that dog.
They're like self-aware, at least.
And like,
do you think it comes out?
Wrap my head around this whole thing because like, the whole movie, he's talking about how he has all this in common with a dog, but like she falls in love with him. And like, I asked Kadish at one point, and I'm like, I can't stop thinking about the fact that he's like a dog, but he's the romantic interest in this movie. And I was like, you think he's got like a red rocket dick?
That's what I was going to say. Yeah. You think it like comes out?
Yeah. That's all I could think of. I was like, that's a deal breaker.
I think they didn't go far enough. I think he should have looked more like Barf from Spaceballs.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that would have been, I think that would have sold it more. Because the way he looks in
the
movie.
They half-assed it.
He looks like an elf.
Either less or way more.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm saying full-on fur.
He had a cool goatee.
No, he didn't.
It was a cool goatee.
Not as cool as ours.
And with pointy, like, wolf ears.
He had elf ears.
Dude, this thing is, like, getting beyond control here.
It's awesome, dude. Yeah.
So, fun fact. Natalie Portman was originally supposed to star in this movie.
I can see that.
Yeah.
She looked at the script and she was like, I'm not reading that.
600
I went to Harvard. I'm not reading this bullshit. Well,
during the wedding scene, Jude was like, is that Amidala?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Kind of looks like her.
They kind of did the wedding scene.
It's like, yeah, where the guy's married.
I've never met you before, but will you marry me, Mom? It's like, ew.
Did you see the ring, though? I'd think about it.
Yeah. You know, the concept of this movie, there's parts of this movie that I thought were really cool. Like the Earth is just some farm,
dude.
Yeah.
That concept is cool.
Yeah, that hit me in that weird conspiracy bug because I'm like,
these people live for 90,000 years or more, and you know, or in whatever. And it's like the idea, like we're gonna populate this planet with some
low life
hybrid species, and we're gonna let the planet come to get ripe over 100,000 years of development. And then when we figure it out that they've used too much of the planet, that means it's time to harvest. So they go in there and they call the whole population and
suck
their human essence out so they can make everybody young again. That's pretty wild. That's really some sci-fi stuff right there.
It's sci-fi stuff, yeah. But like I said, the conspiracy, I don't know if you guys are familiar with like the whole conspiracy behind adrenochrome. You hear about that? It's basically, it's some hormone that is extracted from people at the moment of like top fear. And it's supposed to be like just ripe for the taking at that moment of death. And
sounds
then they extract it. And then like elites use it to keep themselves young, which is like some of the explanations for a while. These Hollywood elites are like 70, but they look like they're 45. Mm-hmm. And it's like, it's some interesting, you know, interesting rabbit hole to go down. But
save that stuff for another show.
I'm tying it back. When this movie kind of went down that same rabbit hole, and I was like, oh, they're trying to tell us something. I don't know. I found that to be
the Wachowskis are in on it.
Yeah, really. The Wachowskis are trying to warn us.
Well, considering what they're going through, they might need that.
Yeah, they were like, this was like drugs. One of them was a brother and one of them was a sister.
The mid-transition.
Yeah, like one of them was transitioning. One of them had fully transitioned. So you can't call them the Wachowski sisters. You have to just call them the Wachowskis, I guess.
That's fine.
Call them the sisters?
I guess you could.
I don't care. I don't want to talk about this.
I think they're just going by the Wachowskis.
That's fine.
But do you guys remember when we did our time travel episode when we watched 12 Monkeys?
Yeah.
And you guys ragged on Terry Gilliam for like...
the Fish Islands.
Good 45 minutes.
I said it twice.
So there's a whole section of this movie that was inspired by Terry Gilliam's Brazil, where they're going through the bureaucracy to try to get her like officially certified as a royal. And Terry Gilliam is the final guy that they have to go through.
Is he the one that they bribe?
Yeah. He's the guy who basically gives them the form like 27B/6 or whatever. Like that whole section where they're going through the bureaucracy and stuff like that was lifted directly from Brazil, which was Terry Gilliam's like most influential movie.
Huh.
And so like the Wachowskis wanted to give him like a little homage during like in the middle of this film.
So having never seen Brazil, when I watched that scene, I immediately thought of Fifth Element. It felt very Fifth Element-y.
Was very heavily influenced by Brazil.
And I also, really, that makes sense. This is all tying together. And I also got a very like Parks and Rec vibe from it too, because I'm a big Parks and Rec fan. And that whole scene was like,
I don't think the Wachowskis were thinking of Parks and Rec when they did that.
Probably not, but it's an interesting thing.
But I just thought it was funny to kind of see Terry Gilliam show up randomly in this movie. And the fact that they were paying homage to him as he was like in their movie. Was interesting, but
Matt had a nerdgasm.
Yeah,
it's also kind of emblematic of the bigger problem of this film is that it's so slow, boring, and disjointed. Like Vader kind of talked about how the whole movie is just one scene of Jupiter having to be rescued after another. And when you're writing a movie, you want to try to stay away from having a very passive protagonist, like where the plot does stuff to the character as opposed to the character driving the plot forward through their actions and stuff. Like if you look at another Wachowski film, The Matrix, the first Matrix, Neo is quite passive up to about
the
end of the second act. And then in the third act, he becomes an active character. And that's when like the movie is really like, whoa, like, you know, stuff's happening.
Yeah.
So like Neo takes charge and he's the character who drives the action forward. But everything leading up to that point was setting the stage for that turn. It was like establishing like him, training him, stuff like that. And that type of thing is extremely, you know, emblematic of a well-written movie. Whereas with this, the Jupiter character just stays passive the entire time. And she just goes from, you know, one set piece to another, to another, to another. And it's boring set piece. It's like, oh, I'm going to go talk to this person now. Okay, now I'm going to go talk to this person. Now I'm going to go through a bureaucracy to get a tattoo. Now I'm going to go talk to this person. Now I'm going to marry this person. You know, like she never actually took control of the movie. Everything was kind of done by the Kane character. I even told Jude when we were watching it, I was like, you know, Kane Wise should really be the main character of this movie. Because he's the one driving all the action.
Yeah.
You know? Yep.
He's the one who sets everything off. And
I would like to point out that Sean Bean did not die.
Yeah, I was going to ask, because I don't remember if he died in the space battle or not.
Well, I think the Wachowski specifically
didn't want
had him live.
It's like, hey, Sean, you want to live in this movie?
That's a thing, too, for him. Like, there's a Netflix show called Frankenstein, I think, that he's the star of. And he even dies in his own show.
Well, spoiler. Jeez.
Sorry. It's been out for a while.
Yeah. I tried watching that and couldn't get past the first episode.
Yeah, yeah, it's kind of rough.
I also tried watching his show, Legend, which wasn't very good either. but Jupiter Jones asks 105 questions in this movie. This was a fun fact where someone actually sat there and counted how many times she asked a question in the film. And it was 105 questions.
I don't know.
That whole Wizard of Oz thing, and she kept saying, I just want to go home. I just want to go home. That makes sense.
Mm-hmm. It does. Did you guys spot Spratt from Downton Abbey?
No. Who's that?
He's the Dowager's butler.
Spratt.
Spratt.
It's the best name in the whole show.
I know.
And he played the Armenian uncle, the one who's like, how dare you?
Try to sell your cousin's eggs.
Yeah. Turn your cousin into a chicken. Like, he was the guy at the dinner table. He was giving her a hard time.
Did you see Rav from Avenue 5?
Avenue 5, yeah. She was in it.
No, I wasn't. I kind of like spaced out in this movie.
Were you watching two things at once again?
No. I gave my attention to this movie, but I was just like, what the fuck?
She was the captain of the Legionnaire ship.
Oh, that. Yeah, her. Okay, yeah. That's right. I do remember that. Anyway, I don't know, man. This movie kind of just went by for me. It wasn't interesting enough to keep my attention.
That's why it was a box office bomb.
Yeah. Visually.
Because everybody else felt the same way.
Visually, it was fine. Yeah. Like, the CGI is all right for that year. I you know, they spent their money on it. It came out okay.
There was a lot that could have worked, but there was just so much that didn't.
You could tell they were trying to set up like a
franchise.
A franchise here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, they really tried to do too much in this movie. They should have simplified it a little bit.
With it being like originally a 600-page script, I just pictured this being like a Lord of the Rings trilogy, and I was like, oh, God.
Well, if it had been good, it would have been fine. But
would the rollerblading wolf have worked if it was more like a skateboard or something, or like a snowboard?
I don't think so.
I mean, no? I felt like
the concept of him like flying around and having that extra upper hand as a mercenary.
He should have just left his wings on him and let him, you know,
fly.
Yeah,
fly.
Winged wolf.
He was in some confined spaces, though. I don't think the wings would have worked.
Maybe a gravity surfboard.
That's what I'm saying. Cooler. I was kidding. Oh. Like Green Goblin from Spider-Man. I don't know. I feel like that would have worked better.
Who does everything outside?
Yeah. I don't know, man. It was a weird concept. I feel like it should have worked. I'm not really sure why it did.
There are rumors about how studio interference kind of hurt this movie.
Yeah. Oh, I can imagine.
Because so they finished filming it in 2013, and they spent like a year on post-production. And you know, the film was released in 2015, but it was originally slated to be released in the summer of 2014. But during the Sundance Film Festival that year, they did a secret screening, the studio did, because they wanted to kind of get a sense of, like, you know, what people thought of it. And it was, the secret screening at Sundance was so disastrous. people got up and left during like this like highly anticipated secret screening. And at the end of the movie, like, normally, like, audiences at Sundance are very kind of respectful, and they'll like clap or something like that. People just walked out. Oh. And every one of them, like, when they were being exit polled, they were like, this movie was terrible. And so the studio got kind of like cold feet.
Do you know how long it was at the secret screening?
What do you mean?
How long was the movie? Was it like way longer? Did they chop it up?
I think it was roughly the same.
Okay.
Just same amount of time. But anyway, so the studio basically decided to push back the release of the film from summer of 2014 to February of 2015.
Oh, that's a dumping ground.
Turned it into a February movie.
Yeah. And the official reason for the delay was they wanted to give the Wachowskis more time to complete the over 2,000 special effects shots that are in the movie. But they really mandated a number of reshoots to make the plot clearer, because a lot of the audience said that they didn't understand what the movie was about. So the cost of the reshoots and the delay ballooned the final budget from its original $130 million to reportedly over $200 million.
You know, I'll bet this movie would have at least broke even if it was released in the summer. People go to the movie in the summer just to go to the movie.
Yeah. Well, they were worried about the bad word of mouth, just tanking it.
Yeah.
So I can understand why they made the decision, but it'd be interesting to see what the original version of this movie was compared to what we got. Because I can't imagine, like, if they went back to reshoot stuff to make it clear. It's still not very clear.
No, it's not. I mean, when if I look back and I try to think of what the plot was, it just seems like Jupiter Jones is the fish out of water, the everyday man who becomes the hero.
She cleans toilets.
She cleans toilets. She's Cinderella.
Yeah.
And she has to stop this alien race from harvesting the Earth. Like, that seems simple enough. But I think the problem is that, like you guys said, she's not really the main character that moves the plot forward. So, like, following her just kind of drags the movie down, as opposed to if we were following Channing Tatum. Well,
I was also telling Jude last night, so, like, at the beginning of the movie, they're trying to kill Jupiter Jones.
Right.
And the reason they're trying to kill her is because Eddie Redmayne's character wants to basically stop her from, like, getting legitimized as his mother's reincarnation, so that he can keep control of the Earth. The minute that she is able to get kind of certified as a royal, he now legally has to get her to abdicate the Earth to him through, like, a contract. And so, like, he can't kill her. Otherwise, like, if she dies, basically she can't, like, release her claim on the Earth. So basically from that point on, he's trying to capture her. So he kidnaps her family in order to blackmail her into signing over the Earth. But at that point, I'm like, you know, like, couldn't he just, I don't know, kill her and then, like...
Very convoluted, like, storyline.
Yeah, like,
maybe the tattoo quits working after the heart stops beating or something, I don't know.
Or couldn't he just force her to, like, you know, grab her arm and put it over, like, that little thing and... Or...
And if he doesn't...
Has to be consensual.
If he doesn't get Earth, if she dies, how come he got Earth when she died the first time?
Well, because she wasn't legitimized as the queen yet.
No. Well, I mean, when she was... Because she's the reincarnation.
No, her will divided up her her empire amongst her three children.
Yeah.
And so he got the Earth in that will.
Okay.
But in the will, it also stated that if she were to be reincarnated, she gets control of the planet on which she was born on, and that just happened to be Earth. And unless you're paying very close attention to the movie, you don't pick up on any of this.
Okay. I did not pick up on that at all.
I kind of did, but I don't care.
Also, I'm glad you brought up the will, because that brings up another flaw in the storyline, which was the wedding. And he was like, if you marry me, then I'll be your heir.
She'll be his heir.
Yeah, but, like, why don't you just draw up a will?
Yeah.
Why do you have to get married?
I don't know.
It didn't make any kind of sense.
Well, it made sense from his perspective, because if he married his mother incarnate.
Also gross.
And then killed her.
The whole movie, she's like, I'm not your mother. I'm not your...
She's
just like...
she's either trying to bang a dog or her son.
Yeah.
No, not his son.
I don't think she was ever trying to bang her son.
But it's funny because, like, so if he married her and then killed her, he would inherit the Earth through marriage. Mm-hmm. So, like, from his point of view, that made sense. From her point of view, she should have been like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
I think we're giving it way more thought than the Wachowskis did.
Oh, I think they thought about this movie a lot.
I think they thought about the wrong parts of this movie. Like, the Wachowskis, you know, other than...
Wouldn't it be wild?
Other than their first movie, Bound, and the first Matrix film, they're not very good at writing movies.
No, they get too overly complicated.
They get too philosophical, and they get too kind of caught up in the technical aspects of things. Like... You know the first big set piece in this movie where they're basically flying through Chicago being chased by spaceships? I've watched that scene now, I guess maybe 3 or 4 times. And each time I'm like, this scene is so fast. I can't tell what's going on.
Oh, yeah. It's all the action scenes in this movie.
Like, it looked beautiful, but it was a mess. It was way too fast. They shot it specifically at the twilight hour in Chicago. So, like, every day they only had like 30 minutes to shoot in the city, because they had to shoot during that period where the sun's rising and you get that nice blue haze in the background. And the city looks beautiful in it, but it's still too dark to tell what the heck is going on.
Wouldn't you be able to fix that? Since most of the scene is going to be CGI anyway, you'd be able to kind of, like, brighten up the contrast a little bit.
Well, but
while still maintaining that kind of, like, hazy look.
I mean, the look of the city is fine, but it's because it's still kind of like dark, that, and the action is so fast paced and the ships are kind of like reflective. So, like, they kind of blend in with the background.
They got a chrome.
Yeah. A lot of it just, like, you know, it goes by too fast and you can't tell what's going on for the most part. And it's a shame because the sequence itself, I think, you know, it took them like fucking months to shoot that thing and prepare for it and do like they invented like this new technology of, they called it like the Rotocam or something like that, where they had like six different cameras mounted to a helicopter that was somehow able to give them a 180 degree shot of like the city. And so technically it was a very impressive scene, but visually it was just a mess because you couldn't follow the action.
Yeah. I don't know. Final thoughts on this movie, guys. Matt Vader, Jupiter Ascending. What do you think? Yeah, final thoughts.
The turd.
Okay. That's fair. Jude?
To quote one of my favorite philosophers, one star crap fest.
Wow. One star
crap fest. I am a philosopher. Yeah. deep thoughts.
I'm gonna quote one of my favorite philosophers, and it's aggressively mediocre.
It was aggressively mediocre. The biggest problem with this movie is that it was boring.
Yeah.
It was just a boring movie.
All right.
I can't believe all the shrilly harpies out there didn't scream because it's just a big damsel in distress movie over and over.
Well, yeah. They didn't exist back then.
In 2015?
Yeah, they certainly did.
I don't know. Whatever.